So in this presentation, I will talk about how you can use the boundary element method in FreeFEM, and also I will talk about FEM-BEM coupling. And so I apologize in advance because it will probably go a little bit fast because it's quite dense and the schedule is already quite packed, but I'll do my best. And so this is the outline of the presentation. So I will first do a very quick recap on what is the boundary element method. And we will see that we will end up with dense matrices that are quite expensive to compute and use. And so then I will introduce compression techniques that can help with that. And we will be using hierarchical matrices. And then we will see how we can use all of this within FreeFEM in order to solve a boundary element problem. I will give some numerical results, and then I will conclude by showing you how you can define a coupled FEM-BEM problem in FreeFEM now. Okay, so I will start by introducing the boundary element method. So this is a very quick summary of basically last year's presentation by Xavier Claeys about the boundary element method that you can find on the FreeFEM YouTube channel. So let's say I want to solve this scattering problem, for example, here. So I have a scatterer omega here with boundary gamma, and I have an incoming wave u inc, and I want to solve this Helmholtz equation outside, basically in the infinite domain. And so I have my Helmholtz equation, and this is I'm looking for the scattering field u. So I have Dirichlet boundary condition on gamma u equals minus u inc, and I have a Sommerfeld radiation condition at infinity, which means only outgoing waves at infinity. And so in order to solve this problem, we will make use of the green kernel function for the Helmholtz equation. So here in 3D, the green kernel takes this form. So sorry, I'll move to full screen. And basically, I can use this function to have this.
Henri, just a question. Do control. Ah, okay. You do.
Sorry, now I'm full screen. And so I will be able to use this green kernel in order to define my scattering field solution at any point x in the outside space. And this basically amounts to now finding p. So I know that there is a unique solution p which lives on gamma, such that I have this equality. And so now, instead of looking for u outside, which is infinite domain, I will look for p on gamma. And if I know p, I know that I can reconstruct my field anywhere in space using this formula. And so basically, in order to define a variational formulation for p, what we do, we will make use of the Dirichlet boundary condition in gamma, and we will impose it in a weak manner. So basically, I will multiply by test function q on gamma, and then integrate on gamma. And I end up with this equation, which basically, where basically I replaced u by this expression. And so now you see that I have a double integral on gamma. And I'm looking for p here, my solution of this variational problem. And this is my right-hand side with the incoming wave. So this is simple integral on the right. But you see that since I have a double integral on the left, with a kernel here that actually is zero, is non-zero everywhere, I end up with a full linear system when I discretize this equation, for example, with P1 basis functions. And obviously, you can already see that the coefficients are quite expensive to compute. We have a double integral, and we usually have a green kernel that is pretty expensive to compute with an exponential here, for example. And so I end up with a full linear system, and then I can solve for P and use this equation to retrieve my scattering field anywhere in space. So this is basically how the boundary element method works. So now I just have a full matrix on gamma that I need to invert. And so here, this slide, just to tell you that, okay, for a given problem, there are usually a lot of different, I mean, quite a few different FEM formulations that you can use, but they all make use of the same four building blocks. And so the four building blocks for any boundary integral method are here. So the single layer operator here, this is the most simple one. And this is just the one we used in the previous slide. And then you have the double layer operator, which basically amounts to adding a normal derivative here, a transpose double layer operator, where the normal derivative is in the other variable now, and the hyper singular operator, where you have two normal derivatives. Okay, and so we've seen that BEM integrals are quite expensive to compute, as you can imagine. And I pass the tricky details about singularities on the green kernels and complex quadrature rules and so on. But basically, we will make use of the BEM tool library in order to assemble the coefficients of such BEM matrices. And so this library is a C++ library that is written by Xavier Kless from Laboratoire Jacques-Louis Lyons, and that handles Laplace, Yukawa, Helmholtz, Maxwell equations, both in 2D and 3D, and can do P0, P1, P2 Lagrange basis functions, and also surface Ravier-Thomas. And it is available on GitHub here. Okay, and now, as I already said, we end up with a dense matrix that is quite expensive to compute and use and store. And so we'll try now to make use of low rank approximations and compression techniques in order to try to lower this, this cost by quite a bit. So let's first start by saying we have a dense matrix B. And let's first assume that I can write B as follows, as such a sum with R terms here, with some vectors UJ and VJ. And you can already see here that if R is small, then the cost is pretty much reduced to linear in N with a few R terms, right? And this is the case when B is low rank. So B is said to be low rank if it can be written in such a format with a few terms in the sum. But obviously it's usually not the case, especially for BEM matrices. So what do we do? So we'll try to compute a low rank approximation of the matrix. So we can first start by always trying to write the singular value decomposition of the matrix B, like this, with singular vectors sigma j and singular values sigma j and singular vectors uj, vj. And the idea will be to truncate the SVD and to obtain, in order to obtain a low rank approximation of B. And you can see that this probably will be a good approximation if the sigma j singular values quickly decrease. Then we can have good approximation by taking only the first few terms in the SVD. But now the new problem with that is the SVD, as you know, is pretty costly to compute and also requires all the coefficients of the matrix in order to compute the SVD. And we already saw that usually BEM coefficients are pretty expensive to compute double integrals and green kernels. And so we'll make use of an approximation technique, which basically computes an approximation of the singular value decomposition, and which is called adaptive cross approximation. And especially in this case, partially pivoted adaptive cross approximation or partial ACA, which needs only to compute one row and one column of the matrix for each term in the sum. So much more efficient than computing the whole matrix if you can have a good approximation with only the first few terms of the matrix. Okay, so then did we win with partial ACA? Unfortunately, no, because usually from BEM matrices, the singular values don't quickly decrease. So here, for example, on the right, you can see the singular values of some single layer operator. And yeah, they decrease, but you can guess that if I truncate and take the first few terms, I won't end up with a good approximation. But what is interesting is that on the left, you can see the absolute values of the coefficients of the matrix here. And you see that on the diagonal, I have large values of the coefficients, and these near diagonal blocks and diagonal coefficients correspond to near field interactions. So basically interactions with two basis functions that are very close to each other in space. And these interactions bear a lot of information and are usually not low rank in nature. So they are not really compressible by any low rank technique. But away from the diagonal, you can see that the absolute values of the coefficients quickly decrease. And these correspond, this far away from the diagonal, off diagonal blocks correspond to far field interactions between basis functions that are far away from each other in space. And in this case, the green function has a very regularizing effect. And then we end up with off diagonal blocks that are very, very well represented by a Lorentz approximation. And so the idea is to build a hierarchical representation of the blocks of the matrix and identify and compress the admissible blocks that can be well approximated by Lorentz approximation. And this is how we will end up with hierarchical matrices. So how does this work? So first you need to build a geometric clustering of your set of degrees of freedom. So let's say we have a surface mesh of a S-shaped cavity here, for example. And let's say we do P1. So first we'll build a geometrical clustering of the nodes of the mesh, a hierarchical clustering like this. And you divide recursively into subsets of degrees of freedom that are close to each other in space. And so this is called the cluster tree. And basically, then you can use this cluster tree to build the block tree. So represent the matrix as a recursive hierarchical block tree, where a block in the matrix corresponds to the interaction of two clusters, one cluster in the target tree and one cluster in the source tree. And what you will do basically is you will traverse your block tree and look for admissible blocks using a so-called geometric admissibility condition. And basically, this condition tells you that looks if the two clusters, the source and target clusters are sufficiently far away from each other in space, then the admissibility condition tells you that you can use Lorentz approximation to get a good approximation for this block. So we traverse the blocks. If we traverse the block tree, and if we find admissible block, we then use partial ACA to compute a Lorentz approximation of this block. And if not, we go down levels in the tree and continue traversing the tree recursively to look for smaller blocks that might be compressible. And then you basically will end up with a so-called H matrix or hierarchical matrix, which looks like this usually, with red blocks that correspond to near field interactions that we were not able to compress because they are not Lorentz in nature. And green blocks that are Lorentz blocks corresponding to far field interactions that we were able to compress with partial ACA. Okay. And so all of these techniques, compression techniques, are implemented in the H2 library, which is a C++ parallel library written by Pierre Marchand and myself, and which interfaces with BEM2 in order to compute the coefficients. And this is a parallel library, which basically makes use of MPI for the coarsest level of parallelism, where the matrix is bound distributed on the MPI processes. And within each bound, we can use OpenMP threads in order to parallelize the assembly and also the matrix vector and matrix products. Okay, so how do we use all of this in FreeFM now? So before going into BEM variational forms, we need to discretize our geometry. So Frederick talked a little bit about surface and line meshes in his presentation. So I will very quickly go over how you can, the different ways to define your surface mesh in 3D or line mesh in 2D. So the first way, as Frederick showed, is to use a square free function with geometrical change of coordinates in order to build, for example, a torus here. So 2D surface meshes is a mesh S in FreeFM. You can also use Move Mesh to Free in order to transform any 2D mesh to 3D surface mesh with a transformation specified like this. And you can also use .gamma in order to extract the border of any 3D volume mesh into a surface mesh. And for the line meshes, you can use the border keyword, which, as Frederick said, you can use z-coordinates now when you define the border. And you can use your border within the build mesh L function, which functions similarly to the build mesh function for 2D meshes. And then you can, for example, build a spring using this build mesh function. You can also extract a part of a boundary of a 2D mesh. For example, here I extract boundaries 1 and 2 of a square using the extract function. And then you can also use .gamma in order to extract the boundary of a surface mesh. And you can find much more operations on meshes and mesh L in the FreeFM documentation. Okay, now on to how to define a boundary operator, boundary element operator in FreeFM. So basically, we have this model equation here with coefficient k. And if k equals 0, you end up with the Laplace equation. If k is positive real, you end up with Helmholtz equation. And if k is positive imaginary, you end up with the Yukawa equation. But these three equations can be handled in the same way in FreeFM. So in order to define a boundary integral operator, you use the BEM kernel keyword. And the first parameter of the constructor will be a string corresponding to one of the four boundary element, boundary integral operator that I already described. And you have this parameter k, which specifies your coefficient. So the wave number for the Helmholtz equation, for example. And we will see also that in order to recover the solution in the volume, we will make use of BEM potentials. And you have the BEM potential keyword, which functions similarly. And these new types, you can use them in a variational formulation in order to define your BEM variational problem. So this is the same keyword as in FEM, so VAREF. But now, as we have seen, we have double integrals. So in 2D, x2D. For 3D, for 2D surface meshes, and int 1D x 1D for 1D curve meshes. And then you use the BEM keyword here and your kernel inside the BEM keyword in order to define your boundary integral operator. And you can also directly define in one line inside the VAREF the BEM kernel you want to use. Obviously, the same for 1D. And then you can make use of the BEM plugin by doing load BEM, which basically loads the interface with the FreeFM interface with HTool and BMTool. And you can build, you can construct the H matrix as a discretization of your boundary integral variational formulation, pretty much similarly to what you do in FEM. And you end up with your H matrix. You also can do a little more complicated formulations. So for now, I just showed you the first kind formulations, but you can also, for example, do combined formulations, which can arise in some formulations for BEM problems, which basically amounts to be able to combine two BEM kernels. For example, here I define a linear combination between the hypersingular and double layer operator. And I can use this kernel to define a combined formulation using the same ideas. And here you also see that usually in the combined formulation, you also have a mass term, which is a sparse term here on a single integral, which is part of the formulation. And you can find in the distribution, so these two are links that link to some examples for Dirichlet BEM problem and Neumann BEM problem in the distribution, which are actually solved using the three kinds of formulation. So first kind, second kind, uncombined formulation within the same script. So you can take a look at that. Okay, and so now we know how to assemble the H matrix. And you have some, here quickly, you have some parameters that you can play with for H tool parameters. So the type of compressor, which defaults to partial ACA, the target compression error for the low wrong blocks, the admissibility geometry criterion, eta, and some other parameters. And you can also change default values using for the whole script using global variables. Okay, and so now that we have our H matrix, how can we solve the problem? So similarly that in what you will do in FEM, you can define your linear form for the right-hand side, which is usually simple integral like in FEM. And then you can solve the linear system using the standard way of doing this in FreeFEM with a minus one like this. And this defaults to solving the linear system with GMRIs using a diagonal preconditioner. But since you also have access to the parallel matrix vector product, you can, and by the way, the parallel stuff is transparent for H tool. And so that's pretty nice to use it easily in the scripts. As Pierre said, you can use this parallel matrix vector product to define some more clever preconditioning schemes using PET-C shell, for example. Okay, and so now in order to reconstruct the solution in the whole domain, we use BEM potentials. So this is similar to define a BEM kernel, but now the keyword is POT. So here is, for example, here's a single layer potential. And you can also define it directly in the variational formulation. And then let's say I have my BEM solution on gamma, and I want to reconstruct the field on a square in the 3D domain, for example. So here I define my output mesh TH out as a square, for example. I will define, let's say I want to recover the field on every node of the mesh. So I define my P1 finite element space on this mesh. And then I will define the rectangular H matrix for the potential using the potential variational formulation. And now it is rectangular, right? The source doffs for the matrix are the doffs on the boundary gamma with UH. And the target doffs are the doffs on my output mesh TH out. And then I just do a matrix vector product with this matrix using my BEM on that, my BEM solution on gamma. And I can recover the solution on my output mesh like this. Okay, and so here, let me just quickly go into some numerical examples. So this is an example. So all of my examples are for the Helmholtz equation. So this is a plane wave scattering by the S-shaped cobra cavity here. And this is a directly boundary condition, and it's solved using a first kind formulation. And the drawback of the first kind formulations are that they are very poor in terms of conditioning. So we need to rely on clever two-level DD preconditioning, for example here, using domain decomposition. And then we are then able to solve the problem in 7 GMRI iterations in 0.5 seconds on 200 cores here. And here is a plane wave scattering by the submarine. Now this is Neumann boundary condition. And we use a combined field formulation, which is a little more expensive to assemble, but much more stable in terms of the conditioning. And now you see that even with a diagonal preconditioner, very simple, I can solve the problem in 38 iterations in 1 second on 1800 cores. And this is, for example, the reconstructed field on a plane around the submarine. Okay, so now finally, let's do even more fun stuff using FEM-BEM coupling in FreeFEM. So now let's say this is the model problem I want to solve. So now I have a domain omega int, and inside I have some heterogeneous coefficients n here for my Helmholtz equation. So I want to solve the Helmholtz equation inside omega int. Let's say I have also a volumic right-hand side in omega int. And I also want to solve the homogeneous Helmholtz equation in the exterior domain outside omega x. And then, of course, I have U, my inside solution, ux, my outside solution, and I have continuity, so I have equality between Dirichlet traces on gamma and between Neumann traces on gamma as well. And so I have usually also a radiation condition at infinity, similarly to what I wanted to solve in my first few slides about the BEM problem. And so in order to define the coupled problem, we start by defining the variational form in the inside domain. So this is usual FEM stuff, right? So this is a weak form of my heterogeneous Helmholtz equation inside omega int that I recalled here. So here, I just replaced the u here by ux in the integral, in the border integral. And so now I will present you how to do coupling using the Bielak-McCamey indirect coupling, which is a little different than the Johnson-Nedelec coupling Pierre was talking about in his talk, but it's a little more simpler to explain, I think. And so as in my first BEM problem that I presented, now I will, instead of looking for u in the infinite domain, I will try to find the ansatz on gamma, the ansatz phi, such that if I apply the single layer operator to this ansatz, I recover ux in any point in space. And so this is notation shortcut for the single layer operator. We already have an integral of gamma and the green kernel here, but this is just a shortcut of notation. And so now I recall that I have equality between Dirichlet traces and also between Neumann traces, between the outside and inside solutions. And here I just replace ux by this new expression using the single layer operator here. So we end up with something like this. And we have a minus here because now this is from the boundary element method point of view, from the outside domain. Now this normal vector points inside the omega int. So that's why we have two different signs here for the normals, and that's why we have minus here. And so now for this first equation, I simply replace my Neumann trace of ux here by this single layer operator here. So I have a Neumann derivative and the single layer operator. So this, you can already guess this will be a boundary integral operator, but we have a double integral, right? This is already integral of the green kernel in the single layer operator. And now, as in my previous BEM example, I can impose the Dirichlet boundary condition weakly using a test function psi on the boundary, and then integrating over gamma. I end up with this equality corresponding to this equality in a weak form. And here you can see that I have a single layer operator, the Dirichlet trace of the single layer, with a minus sign coming from the equality. And so this is my coupled problem. Now I need to find u and phi, which verifies these coupled equations for any v and psi. So u is a FEM solution inside my omega int domain, and phi will be my BEM, so my BEM ansatz on gamma. And so I am able to, so for now we will see how we can build the four blocks separately. So basically I have this diagonal FEM block here, which corresponds to the usual discretization using FEM of my Helmholtz equation. I have this off diagonal block here, which is just a mass matrix on gamma, so this is sparse. And then I have my two BEM blocks, right? So I have this diagonal BEM block, which corresponds to the single layer operator. So we already know how to define this in FreeFM and extract and or construct the corresponding H matrix. And then in the off diagonal BEM block here with the Neumann trace as a single layer, this corresponds to the transpose double layer operator, right? With the normal derivative. And so this is exactly the formula of the transpose double layer operator, which we can define also with FreeFM, with the TDL here. And as I've already said, we have a mass term here, sparse mass term also, which comes from the jump between the Dirichlet and Neumann trace. And we also know how to build the H matrix corresponding to this block. Okay, so now in the five last minutes, I'll try to speed things up. So the cool application I wanted to show you is how we can bend a wave using gradient index lenses, which basically here are circular lenses with a refraction index, heterogeneous material with a heterogeneous refraction index, which has a radial dependency. For example, these two examples here, and you can see how it affects a passing plane wave which passes through the lens. And then now I will just show you the script and run it. So basically the goal for this application is to make a spatial arrangement of few lenses in order to bend an incoming wave generated by a waveguide. So this is the script I want to show. So let me go over it very quickly. So the important part, so this is my complex wave number. This is a number of points per wavelength, 10. So this is some discretization parameters. This is, I want to have 10 lenses. So this is the angular shift between the geometrical, between the different lenses for the geometrical arrangement. This will be the centers of my lenses. This will be the multi-border that I will use to define the borders, the boundaries of my lenses. I also have borders for a waveguide, which I will excite using a source term, a Gaussian source term inside the waveguide. And so with all of these borders, I can build my 2D mesh. This is, will be my 2D FEM mesh, which will have exterior label interface, which corresponds to my gamma at the interface between FEM and BEM domains in my slides. And I plot it. So let me just run it here. Okay, so here you see my FEM domain, right? You see the waveguide, the interior borders of the waveguide inside the FEM domain. And this will generate my impending wave that I want to bend with these lenses. Okay, so and then I can extract the gamma, so the line mesh corresponding to this boundary, and I can plot it. So this is my BEM mesh. And then I have some region stuff that I use in order to define my refraction index for the heterogeneous Helmholtz FEM equation that basically uses the formulas that you showed on the slide in order to define a radially dependent refraction index inside each lens. And then I have my P1 space, FEM space, and P1 BEM space. And now I will define the four blocks. Okay, so we already saw how to assemble the BEM blocks. So this is a single layer operator. And here, for example, I'll display the H matrix corresponding to the discretization of this variational form for the single layer operator. This is a off diagonal BEM block corresponding to the transpose double layer. And these are Helmholtz FEM blocks. So this is the usual FEM Helmholtz equation with the index, my heterogeneous refraction index here. And this is the mass block. And then for simplicity here, I will put all of these matrices in a one sparse large matrix. And in order to solve the problem with MEMS here. And so Pierre already showed some clever things that you can do in order to solve, to define the problem with PETSI and with shell structures. But here, for now, it will do because this is a smaller problem. But if you want to do larger 3D problems, you probably want to look into what Pierre showed. Okay, and here you see that I assembled the four blocks in my global matrix, which is actually distributed. So this I didn't show, but each MKI process holds a part of BEM blocks and also a part of FEM blocks. And here, basically, I densify the H matrices in order to be able to pass them to MEMS. And here then I tell MEMS to to solve the problem to compute the factorization in parallel. This is my right hand side. And then I solve the linear system. I recover my solutions. So this is the FEM solution, this is the BEM solution. And then I want to compute the field, the scattered field outside. So I define my output mesh like this. Sorry, I run out of time, so I'm going a little bit quicker. And then I define the potential with a rectangular H matrix. And then I can do a matrix vector product with my BEM solution in order to recover the solution outside. And then I can plot both solutions. And so let's see what happens. So this is my FEM solution on the FEM mesh. So you can see the wave bending. So this is the absolute value of the solution. And this is a real part of the solution. And then this is a BEM ansatz on gamma that I use in order to reconstruct the whole solution here in the whole output domain. And you can see the wave bending because of the gradient and extensions. And you can see that we have some losses here, energy loss that we could compute. And it probably depends on the way the lenses are arranged. So this is the absolute value. And this is the real part. So I thought that was a pretty cool example to showcase how to do FEMBEM coupling in FreeFEM. So this script you have in the FreeFEM distribution. And yeah, I think I will stop here since I'm past my time. And so I thank you for your attention.
So merci Pierre-Henri. And if you have any question, remark, comment, you are welcome.
I have a question. I think you are supposed to finish at 55. So you see, still have a little.
Oh, sorry. Oh, yeah. Sorry.
Just very naive question. If in your variational formulation for your H matrix, you only have a mass term, what's happening with the H matrix, for example?
So you mean if I don't have
any... Yes, yes.
Okay, so this probably raises an error here.
Ah, okay.
So here it will tell you, okay, this is not a BEM variational problem. Okay. I cannot put it in H matrix. So yeah, it will break at population.
Okay, and so under the hood, if you have a proper VAREF, let's say, do you compress the mass term with the BEM part?
Yeah, so this is basically, for now, this is handled completely with BEM tool. So BEM tool actually computes on the fly the sum of the BEM kernel and of the mass term inside the BEM the BEM tool routine.
Okay, thank you.
Pierre-Henri, I have just a small question. Sometime I want to solve simply a Laplace equation in infinite domain. Can I do that with the BEM coupling? Can I put k equals zero?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so here for now we have these operators. And so if you put k equals zero in your BEM kernel, you will be solving the Laplace equation.
Okay.
And if you do time dependent stuff, you can do Yukawa equation. Basically, you will have a plus instead of a minus if you take k pure imaginary. So you can also have minus Laplace plus a coefficient times u equals zero.
Because sometimes you want to solve Laplace operator in infinite domain with some strong geometry close to zero, in fact.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you could do that like this.
Okay, so I will try.
Yeah, I showed only Helmholtz problems because. Yeah, we usually do a wave propagation problem, but you can do Laplace and Yukawa also. And we are working also with Xavier in order to be able to define Maxwell problems and also elasticity problems. But that's still in the works, but hopefully early sometimes next year, we'll be able to do Maxwell, elasticity, and so on in BEM also.
And the last thing is sometimes I want to have just a piece of my domain with periodic boundary condition, for example. If I want to compute outside a circle, but due to symmetry, I have just a part of the circle, so just some an angle, a quarter of the domain with periodic boundary condition. Do you think it's possible to do that or not?
I think if you are able to handle periodic boundary conditions yourself by doing proper manipulations of your H matrix, for example, and combining DOFs correctly, but you will have to do it yourself, unfortunately, because we cannot we don't handle it for now, but yeah, I think it's possible if you handle the periodic stuff yourself, it's definitely possible.
Okay.
One last question. You said that elasticity and Maxwell were in the works. Is it in the works in BEM tool or in the BEM interface to?
Both. So basically, okay. Maxwell is not. So Xavier is not here, so I'm not. I try to give accurate answers, but basically Maxwell is pretty much done, but needs a little bit of validation still for the BEM tools point side. And then we basically waited for that in order to see how we would define Maxwell's problem in BEM. Because yeah, for vectorial problems, it's a little tricky to define it correctly, I mean, in a proper way, in a variational form, because the kernel usually that you use itself is scalar, but then you have left and right operations in the bar, but basically it would look like something like you have a scalar kernel and then you have sparse operators to the left and right of the kernels that go into the vectorial space. And this is a little bit tricky to formulate properly in terms of the language, so we are not yet sure how to do that. Yeah, and this is for Maxwell, and I think for elasticity it's not yet done in BEM tool, so it's in a less finished state than Maxwell, but it's in the works also. But yeah, you will have to get more details from Xavier.
Thank you very much. Okay. And there is a question by Atsushi in the chat.
Yeah, but I don't know if it's related to the BEM techniques. So Atsushi, you can speak.
Sorry, my question rather than on the solver. So you introduce a hash matrix, and after it's sent to Mapper solver. So what kind of the ordering is better for the Mapper?
Your question is about
It's not H-tool matrix because there are a problem because in FreeFM now, the matrix are called hash matrix and you call hash matrix too. So
not hash matrix, it's a hierarchical matrix. Sorry.
So for now, we basically densify the H matrix and we have dense blocks in the whole matrix. So maybe I can, if you want, I can show you very quickly. So if I display A here, for example,
it contains a hierarchical way, but
We could maybe if we have okay. If the interface with MEMS, for now we have no way because we use a user MEMS interface. But if we can more cleverly, I guess, interface with the MEMS code, maybe we can pass it directly as a low rank structure.
I see. But anyway, now it Mapper receives the matrix as AIJ format, coordinate format. So, okay.
Okay, yeah. So basically, this is far from optimal, but it was more of a simpler solution if you just want to get started with MBEM. Yeah, maybe in the future, we could actually pass low rank blocks to MEMS instead of densifying it and do clever things. But we have quite a ways. To that, I think.
So thank you very much.